Did you know there are witches in the Bible? Today we're going to be looking at a difficult passage from 1 Samuel about a witch or a medium who raises a dead spirit from the grave. Hey, I'm Josh, and this is Understanding the Bible. On this channel, I want to help you understand what the Bible says, what it means, and how it applies to your life. And we're going to be doing that by answering a subscriber's question. They asked me to explain to them about the Witch of Endor. They were confused about that story, and I thought with a name like that, we have to dive in and check it out. So let's go ahead and do that. This is from 1 Samuel chapter 28. So grab your Bibles, follow along, and let's dive right in. We're going to start at the beginning of this chapter just to give a little context. And we see what's happening here at the beginning is that the Philistines are gathering their armed camps for war. So they're gathering their armies to fight against Israel. And David is with the Philistines. This is after Saul has tried to kill him and he's run away. And there's been several things that have happened. It's kind of this long thing of David running away with different incidents with Saul. And he's found himself in Philistine enemy territory where he's protected from Saul and the armies of Israel. But now these Philistine armies are preparing to attack Israel. And so David's kind of in the middle of this difficult situation. He's been pretending to fight Israel. He's actually been fighting Israel's enemies. It's this awkward situation for David, but we jump back in the story to Saul. And what we see is that Saul had already removed the mediums and spiritists from the land. And this is the real language that we're going to be using rather than witch. Sometimes it's translated as witch, but medium and spiritist. So people who like, they connect with the dead. And so the story here is setting up that there were not supposed to be. Saul had removed mediums from the land. And then it goes on to talk about how Saul wants to inquire of the Lord about this battle that's coming up. So the way that Israel, the judges, and Saul as the first king of Israel had typically responded to enemies. This goes all the way back to Abraham and throughout the history of Israel, that when enemies came against the people of Israel, that they would turn to God and seek his guidance in how to handle that situation. This is a common theme throughout all of the Old Testament of going to God to find guidance in navigating difficult choices as God's people. But when Saul tried to inquire to God, God wouldn't speak to him, right? The Lord did not answer him either in dreams. So he prayed and he was waiting for dreams, but he didn't have any. Or by Urim or prophets. So these are some of the typical ways. And if this is confusing, you could dive into this a little bit more. But Saul is just following the typical ways to inquire of God that Israel had used. And they weren't working. God was not speaking to him. So what's he going to do? Then Saul came up with this plan, right? And this is kind of where our story begins. Then Saul said to his servants, "Find me a woman who is a medium so that I can go to her and inquire of her." And his servant said to him, "Behold, there is a woman who is a medium at Endor." Endor is behind enemy lines in Philistine territory. But you'll notice that Saul's cleansing was not quite as thorough as it should have been, right? He had removed all of the mediums, just as God had commanded him, you know, only worshiping God. Remove this witchcraft. But still, when he needed it, he wasn't beyond looking for it, and he was able to find it. So he's been given this advice here about the medium. And so we're going to just continue in the story. Then Saul disguised himself by putting on different clothes and went, he and two men with him. And they came to the woman by night. And he said, "Consult a spirit for me, please, and bring up for me the one who I shall name to you." So this is his request to the medium. Right now he's disguised himself so that she does not know that he is Saul. And so he's just asking her to bring up a spirit. He hasn't said who yet. The woman said to him, "Behold, you know what Saul has done, that he has eliminated the mediums and spiritists from the land." It's an interesting claim because she is a medium, so Saul was not very thorough. But she's worried, right? You know, what if Saul finds out, not realizing that she's talking to Saul? "Why are you then setting a trap for my life to bring about my death?" Because she knows that if Saul were to catch her doing this, she would be in trouble. So Saul swore an oath to her by the Lord, saying, "As the Lord lives, no punishment shall come upon you for this thing." Then the woman said, whom shall I bring up? We're going to look at this word in a little bit. I've highlighted it so we can draw attention to it. Who shall I bring up for you? And then he said, bring up Samuel for me. When the woman saw Samuel, she cried out with a loud voice, and the woman spoke to Saul, saying, why have you deceived me? For you are Saul. So somehow when she called up Samuel, she was surprised, and also she recognized who Saul was. But the king said to her, do not be afraid, but what do you see? So Saul was not able to see the spirit. And the woman said to Saul, I see a divine being coming up from the earth. He said to her, how does he appear? And she said, an old man is coming up, and he is wrapped in a robe. Then Saul knew that it was Samuel, and he bowed with his face to the ground and paid homage. And Samuel said to Saul, why have you disturbed me by bringing me up? Saul replied, apparently Saul is able to hear, or the medium is sharing this message to Saul. All right, so what is difficult about this passage? It's that the medium and the witchcraft of the Philistines seems to be authentic and working. The typical Christian belief is that all of that witchcraft stuff is fake or evil. And how is it working? You know, how is there this story of a king of Israel consulting a witch and she really brings up a spirit from the dead, which is what seems to happen in this story? That's what's confusing. It seems to be saying, yeah, that stuff's real. Whereas Christians typically don't believe that it is. And so we're going to be consulting a study Bible. I've actually looked at a lot of commentaries and notes on this to kind of try to get a range of how people interpret this and see what's going on. But I found the NIV Cultural Background Study Bible. This is also an ESV if you're interested, to be very helpful. So we're going to be taking a look at those study notes. This will be a good practice in how to use a study Bible to understand difficult passages. And also, I think, a good answer to this question. So here we are. With the NIV Cultural Background Study Bible. And I love this study Bible because it really provides insights that may not be obvious to me about the culture and background of the text. And so let's go ahead and start looking at this keyword right here, medium. We'd used witch in describing this, and it could be translated like this, but it's a specific type of witch who brings up the dead. So this term is often paired with spiritist, somebody who talks to spirits, and biblical references. And the main thing that they do is to communicate with the spirit world. And so the Bible in the Old Testament, it looks at these people as definitely being in an evil place outside of God. So it's not necessarily affirming how effective they are, but it is definitely affirming that this practice is one that is opposed to what God calls to. I thought there's a really interesting term here, that the Hebrew word for medium is literally ghost wife or ghost mistress. That's just such an interesting picture, that Saul is going to a ghost mistress, a woman who is connected to, in kind of like a marriage or in a mistress type relationship, a woman who is able to connect with ghosts. And this is really, this word ghost is understood as the spirit of the dead. And then we have more notes here about necromancy and its practice throughout the Near East in this time. And so that's just not the art of raising the dead like you see in video games to be zombies or something, but rather of communicating with the dead. And so there's a good bit of information there, and it's very interesting to understand that this was such a common practice back then and that he's going to consult this type of person. And speaking of this consultation, let's read the notes on the consultation, and it will give us, I think, a good insight. So we see that the word used here is spirit, and it refers to a ghost or spirit of one who has died. There's an interesting etymology, so the kind of the meaning of this root word. It appears that this word is like a loan word, so it's coming from not the original Hebrew language, but other languages surrounding it. And so this is just a theory, but it's a popular one that a lot of scholars seem to think makes sense. And it is that it derives from the word sacrificial pit. And this is really helpful in kind of visualizing what's going on here. That in the other cultures around Israel, they believed that the dead were below them, underneath them, in the place of the dead. And that when the dead came to earth, they came up. This is a little different than how we see hell. Sometimes we see hell as below and heaven above. And it's a little different in the cultures around here and even within Israel. There was a less formed view of heaven and the afterlife as God has continually revealed this throughout Scripture and ultimately revealed it most clearly in Jesus. But what their view was this idea of Sheol, of this underground where the spirits went. So people from different religions would have these pits that were dug, and then they would cast sacrifices. So throw in like a black goat or some other animal, some blood sacrifices, as a way of connecting with the dead. So that might have been what was going on here, that Saul goes to this medium and she's looking into an actual pit that she's throwing a sacrifice in. That's the methodology. Either way, that's the visualization of what's going on, that the spirit is coming up from the pit. We see that right here in verse 11. You know, she says, "Whom shall I bring up for you?" She's saying, who has already died, shall I bring up from the place of the dead to where we are? And then in verse 13, the spirit actually comes up. So let's take a look at that. And we have a ghostly figure coming up out of the earth. And here's the question, right? Here's the fundamental questions of this passage. Does this medium actually have the power to raise a ghost? Is she being effective? And the passage is not clear on this, right? It doesn't give us a defined answer. So it would be wise for us to read this with a little bit of uncertainty. The elements that the passage are telling us clearly are that Samuel really did appear. So there really was an appearance of a ghostly figure. But what does that mean? And one of the things we see is that she was startled. In verse 12, it says, "When the woman saw Samuel, she cried out with a loud voice." This is an idea of surprise and shock, fear. In fact, Saul goes on to say, "Don't be afraid," right? So the woman was afraid and startled. We don't know why the woman was startled, but one reason might be because this was totally different than her usual practice. It's possible that the woman was used to not having actual spirits appear when she did these rituals, that she did the common practice today of telling people what they wanted to hear, of making guesses, of deducing things, and then using the idea of the dead that she could see and they couldn't as a way to kind of get money by telling them things. But something different happened here. An actual spirit appeared. And it's possible that it wasn't this woman's power at all. This was totally different. That's why she was so startled. But rather, God chose to do the extraordinary. And God chose to send Samuel from the dead back. This isn't something that you can expect to happen often or usually, but God did the miraculous to allow the spirit of Samuel to appear to Saul to make clear to him what God was saying. That God was saying Saul's abandoning of God's principles was leading to these problems. Rather than using the spirits, God was using Saul's actual moment of turning away to be the moment where Saul heard the truth of what God was doing. So it wasn't the medium, but rather God who brought the spirit up in this situation. And this is probably the most common explanation for this passage. This is kind of a way of looking at it. And as the study notes make clear here, this passage is not advocating for mediums. It's making clear that that's still not the right way. But even when mediums like get into this, that there's a way that God can show up, that God can speak even in those situations and reveal himself. And so if you're troubled by this passage, I think this answer makes a lot of sense. That this is a pretty good guess at what this passage may be saying. I will say, sometimes the Bible does say things that are a little unclear. And one of the things we have to read when we come to these passages is that there is a bit of discomfort. That sometimes God works in ways that are hard to understand. Sometimes the Bible doesn't explain everything to our liking. And that tension is left in the Bible on purpose. So there is an answer that resolves some of the tension, but we should keep some of the tension too, because passages like this are unusual. And it's okay to recognize that and to be left not totally satisfied that we have a clear answer to this, but to recognize there's more than we know going on in the world, and that God is at work in ways that we cannot always fully understand. Well, I hope this has been helpful to you. If it has, please go ahead and hit that like button, hit subscribe. I'd love to have you on the channel. And if you have a passage from the Bible that's difficult to understand, please let me know in the comments. We'd love to tackle that together as we try to understand the Bible.